Let me invite the panel here for the last 90 minutes of today. We are going to discuss the new generation of public administrators, cooperation of public, private, and community sectors, based on the principles of good governance. So let's do the following. I will ask the panel to join when Terry finishes with the good governance, okay? Because it would be a little bit awkward for us to kind of obstruct the view, okay? So why don't we start, Terry? Why don't we start with you, Dr. Terry Anderson? What is good governance? And you have this beautiful one slide with 9 principles. You have, of course, many more slides explaining these principles. But
I think we can cover it just from this one graph.
But we can summarize with that. Let me turn the microphone back to you.
Okay.
So it's Dr. Terry Anderson, the Associate Professor of Public Administration at Troy University, Florida, as well as a Visiting Professor at Georgia Institute for Public Administration, and the Visiting Professor at the School of Public Management, Ukrainian Pretty
Catholic soon University. I'll just have to stop speaking because all my time will be taken up in introducing me. Thank you. Well, first of all, let me start out by saying I am not an expert in good governance. I'm a student in good governance. I've actually been doing quite a bit of research in this lately because it's become a topic that's become very important to work I'm doing in a lot of different areas. And so it's something that I've had to begin educating myself about. I've generally known about it being in the field of public administration, but it's not something I've done a significant amount of research on until just lately. So I, like you, am still learning a lot about it. So please do not look upon me as an expert, but rather as a very interested student in the area of good governance. This particular information I found in a report, a very large report, put together by the Western Australia Public Sector Commission. And what I liked about it was it's a nice, concise picture of what good governance is really comprised of. And I thought, for the purpose of the MPA students here, who will hear more about this tomorrow, this was just it's a good way to compartmentalize this information to make it easy to remember later on. So that's why I'm referring to this as a way of sort of introducing this open panel discussion about good governance. And when that starts, I'm really hoping that my role becomes just another person on the panel, because I really would like to have a lot of discussion and questions about good governance at that point and just see what everyone's opinions and views and experiences may be with it. So having said that, this commission has identified 9 principles, 9 things that really are essential for good governance. Let's take a look at each one and just talk very briefly about each one. I don't plan to take more than 10-15 minutes to do this. First of all, one of the principles involves the fact that there must be some sort of relationship between government and the public sector in such a way that that relationship is very clear, not only to government and the remainder of the public sector, the service deliverers specifically, but the public. Citizens need to understand this. They need to know what their role is in good governance. They have a very important role to play, but they need to understand what that is. And it's all built around participation, involvement, holding people accountable, requiring transparency, requiring responsiveness. All the things I talked about just a little while ago are crucial for good governance. But everyone has to do their job in order to have it. So it's not just government taking responsibility. Citizens, the public, has to take responsibility as well. Another principle relates to the ideas of management and oversight. Public agencies, their management is responsible for a lot of good governance. Oversight is there to hold them accountable. There have to be oversight mechanisms in place from inside government as well as outside in the public. And everybody within government has to know what their responsibilities are. They have to be clearly outlined. Organizational structure. Public agencies have to be organized in such a way that they can carry out their duties. In some cases, this is going to require changing how we organize public agencies. You know, for so long we've depended upon that strict, rigid bureaucratic structure with leadership at the top, communication flowing down, people at the bottom simply responding to what comes down to them. We may need to change that. We have to be willing to change it. We have to be a little more flexible in the kind of governmental organizations we have. So organizational structure, very important. You have to have effective operations in place. Agencies have to engage in planning. Planning is something that we don't see everywhere. With all due respect to our Georgian friends, planning is not one of your strong suits. If you're Georgian, you know that. I'm not telling you something you don't already know. One of the things that I, just as a personal note, one of the things I found very frustrating in working with JIPA for as many years as I have, is the lack of planning. It's just not something that you, but if you think about it, you can't be blamed for that. Historically, in the lifetime of any living Georgian at this moment, people didn't plan. Someone always told you what to do. There was no need to plan. It wasn't something that was encouraged. Certainly creativity and free thinking was not something during Soviet days that you were encouraged to do. So it's not unusual that planning would not be part of your current culture. But it's something that you need to acquire. Planning is absolutely essential to efficient and effective operations. So agencies, public agencies, need to engage in planning. Strategic planning is very crucial. In fact, at JIPA, just this past academic year, at my suggestion, one of the courses they added to their curriculum in international relations specifically was a course in strategic planning. I just finished teaching it in the last semester again. It's a skill that is desperately needed there and something that people need to start doing. It just makes everything work better. Ethics and integrity. We've talked about this, the fact that after the collapse of the Soviet Union, corruption in transitioning countries in Eastern Europe and in the former Soviet republics, corruption has been a serious problem. I'm not telling you anything you don't already know. Again, it's not that you're totally to blame for that, but if the problem persists, you do have to bear the responsibility for it. If you know it's a problem and you're not trying to fix it, now it is your fault. So at some point, it's something that has to be addressed. But there are ways to deal with it. As I talked earlier today with the MPA students, we can legislate ethical behavior. We can educate people concerning what is ethical behavior. We have ways of dealing with the problem. What we have to have is the collective will to take it on and to be responsible enough to try to deal with it. But we all have to do that. We all share in that. We have the same problems where I come from. So I'm not picking on anybody here in this room. This is a universal problem when you have a political environment. Corruption is going to be an issue. So ethics and integrity and, you know, good behavior, which is what we expect from public officials, we have a right to have it, but we have to make it happen. The people within agencies have to be managed effectively in order to be able to deliver the kinds of services that you expect under a system that approaches what we could call good governance. We have to have people who are adequately trained, people who understand the need for ethical behavior, people who are willing to be responsive, to hold themselves to high standards, to be not only personally accountable, but accountable to the public they serve. To have all of that is required for good governance. So we have to have effective human resources management, which involves having people trained who know how to manage people. That's why we have MPA programs like this one, to prepare leaders for that kind of responsibility within public agencies. Finance. We have to have the financial backing, the financial resources necessary for government to do its job. So those things have to be in place. Now certainly, the overall economic condition of a country as well as global economy has a bearing on whether that's going to be adequate. but it's something we have to work within what we have. But we, at the same time, we have to be able to fund what we say we're going to do. So we have to have some sort of financial integrity to the system. And someone has to take care of that. Someone has to have oversight over that. Communication. This is a very broad area. Not only does it imply technology available to be able to communicate effectively, but it requires communication skills. I spoke with the MPA students earlier today about the fact that public administrators are required to do a lot of writing, so they have to have good, sharp, written communication skills, but they also have to be able to speak effectively to different groups of people, whether it be employees in internal staff meetings, or citizens in community groups, or public officials when it comes to budget hearings. You've got to be able to communicate effectively in a whole different variety of settings. Good governance requires it. Not only do you have to be able to communicate effectively, but communications must be out in the open. We have very strict laws in America that require that any conversation or any communication, whether written or oral, involving the functions of government can only be conducted, where decisions are going to be made, can only be conducted in the open. They have to be. And it's very important. People cannot be given the full range of participation opportunities in government if they're not open to communication, if they're not privy to what's going on. So participation is stifled if people can't be informed. So communication is critical. And finally, risk management. Public organizations have to do risk assessments. It's actually part of strategic planning. It's also part of project management. Any sort of overarching coordination of activities involves some kind of assessment of risk. Where are the obstacles? Where are the things that could stop us from accomplishing what we need to do? We have to be able to assess that. So those nine principles, the relationship between government and the public, management and oversight of government agencies, organizational structure that's flexible enough to allow people to be able to do what they're supposed to do, effective operations based upon strategic plans, ethics and integrity in behavior as well as in decision making, effective leadership of people inside government, financial integrity and adequate resources, communication, and risk management are all essential elements of good governance. And so that gives us at least a starting point where we can raise some questions and begin to talk about not only problems that exist, but maybe potential solutions to those problems.
Terry, let's really open the floor for questions so we have more of interaction. Let me ask first almost obvious question. So you know both Ukraine and Georgia, you know, so you know the point A. Let's suppose this is point B. Okay, you already mentioned planning, but obviously you're heavily involved in education yourself. What else is needed to come from point A to point B in your opinion?
I think one thing that I have already seen evidence of existing, now to what extent it's been effective, I don't know, because I haven't talked to anybody about it to be able to speak to that. But I know that there's been a lot of attention from Ukraine on what's happening in Georgia. There are people here who have talked to me about the fact that they've watched what's going on in Georgia. They've watched Georgia's transition. And I can tell you from having started working in Georgia in education, but still I was around, you know, talking to people, in 2000, in watching the growth and the change that's taken place in Georgia from 2000 until today, I can see that Ukraine is on a path to be able to follow that in a delayed way. In other words, you've gotten off to a later start, perhaps, with some things, particularly in dealing with corruption. Georgia had one of the worst corruption problems in the world in 2000 when I first started there. Transparency International had them ranked at second or third, most corrupt. So this is a problem they have begun to address. Now, have they solved it? We haven't solved it. No one has solved it. But they certainly made tremendous strides in improving it. And they've done it both through education and through legislation. Those are the two approaches they've taken.
And through enforcement.
And through enforcement. And they did some of it in a big way. Around 2003 or 4, around in that time, the city government in Tbilisi essentially, as I understand it, fired the entire police department, basically, and started over. Basically started over. When I first started going there in 2000, my friends, when we would walk down the street, the friends that I had acquired there would literally surround me to shield me from groups of police officers that would be standing on a street corner because they felt they had to protect me. You don't feel that way anymore. Now you feel like you can walk down the street and the police are not who you have to necessarily be worried about. But that, when you think about it, 15 years, that's not a long time to make that big a change. So, and I see Ukraine kind of following the same route, but getting off to a later start.
I would like to ask you, what's your opinion about like using, first of all, Georgian experience? For example, you mentioned about police reform, but we also should take into consideration the fact that Georgia's population is almost the same size of big Ukrainian city's population. So it is easy for Georgia to fire in a day all police department, not only from the capital of Georgia, from Tbilisi, but in all country. And so remake totally the police department, but what will cause it Ukraine? How many policemen it actually Ukraine has? I think that they are more than 70,000. Georgia had 70,000, and actually
300,000.
So yes, it will cause even more problems what it caused for Georgia, because it also creates people who are against the government, who are for the opposition, and so who have the revanchist attitudes towards government, and they also can be a reason of political crisis. What we saw, for example, in 2012, like the return of some revanchist politicians who were against the reforms which were implemented by previous government. So what should actually Ukraine do? Because Ukraine cannot just copy-paste like Georgian reforms and cannot just implement them, because they just will not work. And also the temperament, cultural approaches, and the other experiences actually are also different with some kind of situations.
In large part, I have to say I don't know, because I honestly don't know enough about Ukraine. When I was a student studying Ukraine, it was in the 1970s. It was a quite different place than it is now. And I have to confess, there's a gap in my knowledge about Ukraine from the 1970s until now, because it wasn't an area that I was focusing on. So I'm just since I began working with UCU here in February, I've begun to try to read up as much as I can about Ukraine. I'm not suggesting that Ukraine can simply apply the same practices that Georgia has and get the same results. What I'm suggesting, though, is because of a common history that they share, there's reason to expect that there's a certain amount of modeling that might be able to take place. At least it gives them a repository of options to consider. Now, beyond that, every country's going to have to customize its own transition. The bottom line is, though, when you think about things like police reform in the public sector, when we look to the public sector for services that we expect from government, there's an element of trust built into that. We look to government as something that should be benevolent. It should be willing to take care of us. That's its job, at least from our perspective as citizens. And so with that, there's almost like a parent-child relationship in a way. You trust that government to have your welfare at heart. When you have a public organization, like a police department, who has the ability, the capacity, to either make your life very good or very awful, you have to trust them a little bit more. Their job is to create an environment that is safe and secure, that makes you feel like you can go out and walk the streets, that you can go out and you don't have to worry about anything happening to you. When you can't trust the people responsible for doing that, what do you have? You have nothing. That's why we have to start with public organizations like police departments. We have to clean them up first. because the harm they can do is much worse than what other public agencies can do. So that's why Tbilisi, I think, took the approach that they did. It was a radical approach. But they needed to do that in order to clean up that segment of the public sector. It was very effective. Almost, and it was effective fairly quickly. That's what was so remarkable about it. Now, does that mean that every police officer today is a good person? Probably not. Does that mean that there is never going to be corruption in the police department? Probably not. But it was an approach that worked for them. Whether it would work here, that's another question. But it's an option that led to a good result that at least could be a point of discussion.
First of all, it's my pleasure to be here to meet Ukrainian students, not only colleagues, but students, and to listen topics connected to public administration. My presentation will not be long. I will try just to name some main challenges in Georgia in teaching public administration and in public administration itself. I think these two fields are mostly underdeveloped in Georgia, even after reforms. What is public administration? We have a lot of definitions and a lot of theories, and I will not discuss them, but just to take one, the simplest and the most classical one, public administration studies what government does do and what government does not do. And involvement of citizens in decision-making process. And that is the huge challenge in post-Soviet cultures. We are continuously discussing here, even today morning, last days, the post-Soviet complex is that people need correct answers, right answers, politically correct answers. Just from my experience, it's another anecdote, but it happened. Several years ago, I was involved in doing research by one of the bigger and serious non-governmental organizations, CRRC. It is doing surveys and researches in Georgia, Armenia, Azerbaijan, about every field. And my research was some kind of measuring values. It was interviews, anonymous interviews, with absolutely private questions, like what kind of movies do you like and how do you spend your free time, or what do you prefer to buy if you have money? And people were asking me, please tell me what is the right answer. Can you imagine? They didn't know what do they like. In such society, in the society that absolutely lacks the critical thinking skills, it's not easy to govern. Or it's very easy to govern, on the other hand. And I think the main problem still in Georgian public administration sector is that decision-making process is not horizontal, it's still from top to the down. Now about teaching public administration. It's relatively new field. It's difficult field because it consists of different fields. Many universities have now this program in Georgia, and GPA is definitely leader, Georgian Institute for Public Affairs. I will not speak about GPA because Mrs. Terry Anderson is a member of this team.
And by the way, just connect the dots. It happens that Terry knows that in 95, I was working for Open Society Institute Budapest, which is the spending arm for George Soros Foundation.
Yes.
And it was one of the biggest projects we had at the Institute for Local Government and Public Service was GPA.
Yes.
So I was also involved into creating a little bit in creation and streamlining of GPA.
Sex forces. okay. And I think it will not be politically correct to evaluate other programs for me. But let me bring some quotations of research that made Civil Society Institute in Tbilisi last year. They have research about public administration teaching in all Georgian universities. And to say shortly, their conclusion is that this field is underdeveloped because of some main reasons. For example, that they are giving some basic and theoretical skills and not practical at all. Not specialization at all. That government is not interested, of course they are not interested, to have developed public administration fields. And this teaching process is not connected to some kind of public services and bodies. Even international donors are not so active. GPA is leader because of interest of many international donors, but this process had stopped after, unfortunately. So, but we hope that we will do something in this field also in the future. Our program is not born yet. It will be born maybe next year, but we're thinking about this program seriously. Thank you. If you have any questions, maybe it's good to have discussion. Thanks.
Thank you for your experience and for your insights. Just two short comments, if I can make. Number one is, we obviously have the same competitor, that same type of competitor in Ukraine, which is Ukrainian Presidential Academy of Public Administration. And when we are a little bit a latecomer into the field, I mean the Ukrainian Catholic University, because Kyiv Mohyla Academy, which is another renowned Ukrainian university, started a similar program 2 years ago. So the question that we had was, what is our differentiation? Very clearly, you know, and very narrowly, you know, because again, if you are the first mover, you can afford not to think about this because you're the first mover. If you are not the first mover, then the key question is, in what ways are you different? Because if you're not different, you're not needed. Okay. Now, I believe, and it's not just my belief, I mean, it's basically evidenced by people who came here, is that we are different. Because otherwise they wouldn't come here. They would come to the stronger, bigger competitors, right? So number one is, what is our differentiation? And you mentioned some of the needs for the differentiation based on the research that you have mentioned. And the shorter comment, I don't know how the relationship with Jupa and Terry allows her to help and participate, but anyway, she's there for March. So, nobody precludes from dinners, at least, right, Terry?
Well, I wanted to, just in response to both your comments and to what Gvanca said, she said something very important. One of the things that she said was lacking in education and public administration is the ability to think critically. We have to teach students to do that. And this is for the benefit of all the students sitting here now. If you don't take away anything else from this program, you need to be a better critical thinker when you leave here than you were when you started. The most important question in your vocabulary right now should be why. You should ask why we do everything. And then go find the answer. It's all about being able to look at something and explain it. So critical thinking is absolutely essential. In the Soviet days, not only did you not have to think critically, you were not encouraged to think critically. Just do what you're told to do. Follow the norm and just do that. But now we have to ask why about everything. It's very important. Because as you said, if we're not doing something differently than we've ever done it, it's like there's a television celebrity at home, Dr. Phil. He's a psychologist. He says something to this effect all the time. If you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always got. Until you do something different, nothing's going to change. And if something's not working, it needs to be changed. So you need to learn to think critically.
Yeah, I assume we talk about education, public administration here, and as our institute work reason for a non-government, non-profit sector here in Ukraine for 6 years, as mentioned. I would like bring to our discussion some my reflection, some point that actually relate to the third sector. And I think we all have common goals to build a civic society here in Ukraine, Georgia, and with the help with international friends help here us. I'll just bring some reflection and then we can discuss, and I will actually grateful if you have some comments on that, because really by creating education program for public administrators as well as for civic leaders, we are related and we cross, but also we add to each other. I'll a little bit think about our situation here in Ukraine now, and how the civic society and how civic leaders influence into public administration and into education. And I think the two challenges I saw that is really crucial now. The first one is lack of the model of collaboration between administration and the governance and civic society organization. Our recent past tradition is the relationship between government and civic society organization is a relationship more to monitor, to investigate, to watch, to control, kind of be watchdog for government, what government are doing. Now we are in situation when this function still needed, but very important to build a new model of cooperation. How these two sector can doing their own business, bring common result and collaborate. And I think there is a few initiative that successfully done in Ukraine, but still there is no model, no instrument that could be transferred into all regions that described as a model. And here is a gap education could come and try to solve as a case study, as a thinkers, as a model that we can try, we can test, even as education task. And the other things also very interesting we can observe now in Ukraine, when the function of government is replaced by civic initiatives. We have very interesting renovation packet for reform. It's an initiative of civic leaders, experts, different people who come together and actually take a task that government has to create reforms, develop a new law, and they do it much more efficiently than governments do. In a different way, the effectiveness of this could be seen in different way. The number of reforms they develop and propose, the communication that supports their work, I would emphasize on this especially, the openness and involvement of different target group into this development process. The other example is the Nestor group that think about the strategy of our country, which actually should be also take by our national level government. So these two things that are going on in Ukraine, how the education program can help either solve it or bring it into model, into successful model that we can take into our future. No answer, the two question I would like to share.
I'm not just trying to be so negative maybe, or just saying about problems, because what we are here, I hope we are a part of solution. Maybe what we don't have enough skills, we don't have enough maybe not so good values as they should be there, just not enough character, all kind of stuff. But
Natalya,
I guess
you didn't sleep well this night. I mean, why are you undermining yourself so much? You know,
I just mean that
he was in a train from Odessa to Lviv. Obviously, yeah. Usually he is much more upbeat than that. He's from Odessa, you know. So. Yeah.
But I just want to continue that it's just a problem of time and sometimes problem of sleep. So that's my comment. Just let's be more like empathetic and positive about everything. It's just a problem of time.
Let's be positive.
Yeah. I'm not even agree that it's harder to change police in Ukraine. Well, there are some like specifics, but it's just a problem of time. Nothing else.
Hello, everybody. First of all, I'm Tony Karevishvili. I represent Ulhan Saba Teaching University. I work in National Bank of Georgia. I'm happy to be here to come here, share with our experience, share the experience that we as an ordinary citizens, but also the people who are closely related to the people who conducted the actual reforms. And I would like to say one of the members who was actively involved in these reforms is present here, and I'm sure he will have the opportunity to address the issues more thoroughly. But I will address from the outset. I will address only one point: what we have raised about the reforms of police. Of course, it's challenging. Of course, Ukraine is a bigger country; population is bigger. But at the same time, this country has like bigger opportunities, bigger potential, and we said a cultural issue as well. I think Georgians are more, hot people, you know, with temper. Whereas Ukrainians are more level-headed, let's say. Maybe it's speculative reasoning, but also I think a lot of advantages could be done here. But what I know from Georgian example, it's my personal opinion, these reforms must be conducted swiftly. You know, if you prolong the reforms, which are painful, and you don't have medicine to take the pain away, you have to be very quick. And hesitation in this process might be very negative, and it might have a negative result on the country. So you have to be sure which are the priorities, because if you have like 10 priorities, at the end of the day, result will be either nothing or very ephemeral. So you have to prioritize. Yes, we say the police is very important. Yes, it is. So go ahead and you have to do that. But what we didn't do in Georgia, we trusted to the government. Actually, it's more complicated than I'm saying, but yeah, we trusted to the government, let's say. Government did some things really well, but what was lacking was like public supervision, public involvement in prolonging these reforms. And in the beginning of this conference, we said like reforms, maybe someone will take this from the beginning and start to conducting reforms, but the rest of the society, including the NGO sector, non-governmental organization as well, should be actively involved in this. And yes, you can do a lot of good reforms, but if you want the sustainable result, the public sector, the private sector should be involved in that. And you shouldn't copy-paste, we said like copy-paste reforms, but to take something which is the most essential and to consider the mistakes what we have done throughout this way during the reforms. And with the police, with regards to police, it's not about the firing police officers. It's about like changing mentality, values, promotion of values and principles, that ordinary policeman doesn't take a bribe, not because of he has a good salary or he's sitting in a good car, because he believes that he's really doing really good things, because during the history of his country, nobody in his position were doing the same. So this is promotion of this idea, not by the politicians only, that was the mistakes, but people should like support them as well. And at the end of the day, I'm sure this will have the result. And last point, what we did not do in Georgia as well, and we had the results of it in 2012 election, it's my personal point of view as well. We started reforms in education not late. We had some reforms, entire exams in Georgia, which was quite efficient, but continuation was like not really efficient. Actually, there was not at all. So if you don't couple the reforms in police with very comprehensive and very, very thought, like invest and like a very good planned reform of education, many things what we will do might be not that efficient, and something might go wrong, and all those things what you have done might be endangered, and this is unacceptable. We can like tell you this in advance.
Sorry, just I forgot to introduce myself. My name is Georgi Kopronidze. I'm a lecturer at Georgian American University at School of Law, Social Sciences and Diplomacy. Actually, my research and study field is international security, and I'm specialized in international terrorist issues, and I study radicalization of Islam in North Caucasus. So that's like what I'm specialized in, and I would like just to address about reforms, and I can't say that, and I cannot not to be agree with Tornike. I'm absolutely agree with him when he mentioned about changing mentality, and I will just remember one thing from my childhood when these reforms were implemented in early 2000s, like after the Rose Revolution, that everybody used to call like police officers thugs or dogs, like Georgian slang,
dogs.
And nobody called them after a year because like the approach of people towards law enforcers was changed. So it's like much more than salary or cars. But my like key question now is about the civic organizations or non-governmental organizations. So what do you think? Does a non-governmental organization always mean like civic society organizations? Because we also see that there is also problem in transitional societies like Georgia, like Ukraine, or like any other former Soviet republic who is just forming their societies, that sometimes this civic sector is going out of society, we can say. So they are forming another branch or another like group of interest which is out of civic society, and sometimes we can even say that they are trying to be somebody like either self-proclaimed enlighters, or either they can be somehow like the new commercial activities. For example, in Georgia we have more than 16,000 non-governmental organizations. Do they represent civic society? That's my question. So, and if not, so where is the question? So where is the problem? So what's the problem? That civic sector, which is in Georgia now called third sector, it's something also new for us, or like the third field, to become a true part of civic society. Thank you very much.
I just have to confess, we have a similar challenge here in Ukraine, as you mentioned, and my answer would be there is artificial civic society organization too. And the role of civic society organization is to be representative of society into different discussion in front of government, bringing issues society face or thinking on solution for this issue. It happens that not only in post-Soviet territory. It's happened, you know, maybe Derek can tell more about that. It's happened in different countries too. There's different organization because there's different people. For some, the mission is the most important things in their life, and the value, it's something they are driven by. But for some, it become a business and they think how to do it officially. But also, I would separate the NGO that work in particular field, especially those who work with social issue. I think they also present the society, but their role is more to be a professional organization, professional structure to solve different issue. Sometimes government also do. Like educational organization, think tank, social organization, they work with different social groups. Those organizations may be really not involved into reform so much, or could be involved as an expert in their field, in their target group. But generally, real civic society organization present society and build it. It's my opinion. How to deal with those artificial? There is a question, yeah.
We need to make sure as citizens that we don't become guilty of merely, again, giving up our opportunities for involvement and letting somebody else take care of it for us. We did that with government. Government came in, we said, okay, you take care of us. When government stopped taking care of us to our level of satisfaction, we let civil society organizations come in and we said to them, you help take care of us. We keep delegating this out instead of taking that responsibility for ourselves. And I think in fairness to ourselves, we need to make sure that we don't just drop out of the process in favor of letting other people do it for us. The civil society, I think, is a great thing in terms of representing us and serving as advocates for us. But at the same time, I don't want citizens to give up their responsibility for their own welfare. We need to make sure that we don't let ourselves fall out of the process in doing that.
I want to say about another...
If you can turn so that people...
My name is Taras. I'm student of MPA, and I want to give another point of view. We all said that we can fire a few thousand of policemen in one day or in one year, but we cannot find in Ukraine all citizens, because we have a problem that we have no policemen have no values, good culture, and we also have no culture in society. And my fear and my question: do you have some recipes or some examples of countries who have done this huge task? Because we have a large history of non-thinking society that have no critical thinking. And I think it's the main problem, our main problem of Ukraine now. And how we can solve it in a few years, for example, task, and what we can focus in. And I am like a student, want to know where I can find the information, where can must be my focus in.
I don't know if there is one issue which you reminded us about the reanimation package of reforms and how effective they are. And I just started thinking about it right now, and some issues rose up in my mind which I want to raise and see if you agree or disagree. So basically, before the revolution, there have been many different NGOs working by themselves, experts doing their own job, think tanks and so on. During the revolution, the critical moment came where all these people and organizations decided to unite in this coalition of reanimation package of reforms to have more power to interact with the government and to influence the politics and the reforms in Ukraine. But right now, as this pressure of I would say human life and so on a bit went down, I see reanimation package of reforms did a lot of good things, created many, many good reforms, but right now I see it like this synergy of this coalition is going down a bit. The organizations who are there, they have their own like ambitions and their own plans, and I think it falls apart a bit. This is my own perspective. How do you see, do we need to have this critical atmosphere around for the coalition to work all the time, or what's your take on that?
I will not give my own answer because I think the answer is already here. I'll just pick up few phrases that the people already said. There was question: is there a country where citizens are a real citizen? I think we all want to live in idealistic world, but we live in realistic world. I don't have positive answer for you. There is a more or less better situation in some countries than in Ukraine or in Georgia, or there is a country with a worse situation too. The question is how we deal with situation, but not where is the best way, where is the better land to live. And for your question, you just mentioned it, just natural. You say in one moment that this process is natural. It's really natural. And then the Terry said that the question is not about the civic society organization, but about us as a citizen. Really, we want to delegate. It just then blames that they don't use fully or in the best way our trust to them, or would we like to influence, or sometimes maybe to pick up their work too? As a marathon, if, it's a difficult to run marathon, but if there is a distance, you just give to others, you stick. How do you call it?
Relay.
Estafet. Yeah, it's a relay. There's much more easy to come to the finish.
I've seen you like this. It was with Valerie Becker, among others, idea, and I've seen you liked it a lot. So I mean, yeah. Facebook is good because if you read it carefully, you know what people think, especially that you try to follow. So
I don't think reanimation bucket of reform is the organization or the unit that will come to serve for all of us and to bring us to the heaven. They're doing their job better than government, I would say. But also, of course, the natural way for them is going down. There's people, there's conflict of interest, just burnout process. It's all
egos,
very natural.
Egos, price,
yeah, all very natural. The question, we as a citizen, what do we expect for them and how do we react on the issue they do have. I don't idealize them.
Okay. Professor Abdaladze, excuse me my ignorance. In Georgia, it's one-party government, right? Or is that a coalition at the moment?
Sorry?
In Georgia, do you have a coalition government or one-party government?
Not one-party government.
It's a coalition government. So how does that work in Georgia?
Self-proclaimed coalition.
That's Georgia. Yeah.
But technically, it's one-party government. But philosophically, so they said that they are Polish.
The general from NGO, actually.
But as they just named themselves coalition because they formed coalition before election. So as a rule, so the coalition government is a government which is formed after election. So as this government is called, this coalition called before election, so it's one-party government, but named as a coalition government. Yes,
much more profound answer to that.
I absolutely agree with Mr. Gigi. Let me talk a little bit about my attitude to reforms, and I think it will be the answer to all the questions somehow. I do believe that if you want to do successful real reforms, yes, you have to use your hard power and do it like surgery very quickly. Of course, they will be painful, but if you are doing them longer, they are becoming more painful even.
We know.
Yes.
We are doing that for 25 years.
It's better just
we're
to do
alive,
it.
Okay.
Yes. Just do it. Just do it and don't think so much. But it is not enough also. For sustainability of the results after, you need some soft power also. And I think it's much more difficult in our societies because it needs citizens, yes, to be involved in the process, and we have no other citizens. Yes, I agree with you. We cannot just fire all the citizens in Georgia and in Ukraine. But in my opinion, there is another third way, like to use smart power, yeah, also. What do I mean? I know educational system. I can't speak about other systems somewhere. I know educational system somehow in Georgia. I have worked for several universities, for bad universities also, and I do not believe that it's possible to transform bad university in a best university. Yes, Mr. Gigi is absolutely the only example of the
doing
I think that it's better just to create alternative, just to create the new one, alternative to this bad, and to put them in competition. But for this, we need prosperity, money, peaceful development. And this means that our reforms are not only our reforms, they are much more connected to global issues, to issues of security, to issues of our big neighbor, and so on and so on.
You heard Terry's talk. If you could give, I don't know, three principles of good governance to your opinion, of Danish government, yeah.
Dutch. I mean, it's personal opinion. I can get that, but I think that those are like the basic things that are also in the slide there, the checks and balances on every organization. And I think the Dutch have a really good mentality for watching every last penny, especially in government spending. Every last penny is accounted for. So I think for accountability, we're doing quite all right.
Accountability is the key.
I wouldn't say it's the key, but...
What is the key?
I don't have a key, to be honest.
What's your guess about the key?
I think he said like accountability. And
I wouldn't pretend like I know the overall answer.
Nobody knows, but you know, we debate.
Yeah,
that's why we are here. No. Or
So when I was a child, and of course the European Union came, and we had to make a lot of changes. So we received a lot of money, but then a lot of things start changing in our countries. So the reason I like Georgia, I see a lot of the old culture still in Georgia, and it feels very real. In Ireland, it's because of the EU, we lose a little bit of our sovereignty. Anyways.
Did you lose the sovereignty too to the EU?
Yes, I do not have. I do not remember 80s and 90s, so I cannot actually assess whether we lost something or not. But actually, talking to my parents, how they assess the way of reforms of Poland, that's actually really good that we were good or not. But they really like that changes. So I cannot agree that we lost some sovereignty and it was actually on the wrong path of which was taken at the beginning of 90s. But from my perspective, I think it was a really good decision by Polish decision makers. However, I do not remember it on my own because during the nights, not like small.
I was wondering, you know, what would be the answer, because Mateusz is in a very peculiar position. He's Pole, but working for the EU in Ukraine, you know, so it's not that easy. Okay, so let's ask the easier question from Taras.
Yep.
You know, do you still remember that? So, you know, how do you fire the whole country? How do you all fire the whole country?
Yes.
You know, how do you transform the whole country? Not firing the country, right?
In this case, not exactly to fire the whole country, but maybe I can say that with small reference to our expert on ISIS and criminal right now, that for the time being, for example, we have hundreds of experts. When you just switch Facebook, for example, everyone comments on, everyone is an expert on security issues, yes. I remember like when the revolution in Ukraine started, everyone was expert on Ukraine, like everyone actually in Poland, talking to my grandma, to my mother and to my father, everyone was expert on Ukraine. Actually, it's a big problem with civil society, for example, like now, and that to which extent civil society actually should cooperate with the government, because each organization could be could call itself as, let's say, representative of civil society, but to which extent this group will be able to provide some good analysis and good material for the government, it's another question. So you need some experts, you need education, you need other different perspectives, let's say, analyzed as well. So programs as Masters of Public Administration, I think, developed both in Georgia as well as in Ukraine, are needed.
Good. Yes. Where is Nastya? Nastya, take the mic.
Okay.
No, I can do it.
Okay. I will answer this very briefly. I won't try to steal your time. I would like firstly to reflect a question of Taras, because there are no recipes or panaceas. There are just historical precedents and examples how different nations somehow outlived and went through transitional process. So we could use this as an example to see this. And of course, we won't find exact answer for exact country, exact nation, because every case is individual. That was my reflection, for example, that I said that we should not try to copy-paste reforms. So I didn't mean that Ukraine is doing this. It's just that we should not do this. So like an option. And on the other hand, of course, there is literature, there is information where to get it about transformation of Eastern European countries, about transition of Poland, Czech Republic, Slovakia, and other countries. So we can learn on their examples. And in general, it's about the social process and social transition, transformation, how society started to change from one regime and one system to another. So actually, that was also sense of my question about NGOs. Does they always reflect the situation which is going in society? So does NGOs or civil society organizations, so-called, always reflect the true social processes which are going in society? So when we are studying countries, when we are studying societies, so we have to look deeper than only about the organizations and their activities, because sometimes, especially when we have like the transitional period, we get some groups of interest, I can call them like representatives of civic societies. They are representatives of society, but they are part of the bigger one, so like the bigger whole. And so that's also like my reflection about this. So when we speak about artificial or government organized NGOs, so that's one thing. The other thing is how the social process actually reflects how the country is changing, and education here is also crucial. And that was quite good point about experts. In Georgia, even the word expert is something like the word preacher or prophet, like the synonyms, because yes, everyone. And so everyone says that they are expert of something, but there is no actually expertise. That's why, for example, I say that I study something. I don't know this. I try to study and get some information, because I have another problem. I even could not find scientific supervisor for me in Georgia for my doctoral thesis. But we have so many security experts at the same time in the country, but I can't find one who will somehow check if I'm writing my doctoral thesis properly, if I'm applying to some information properly, and if I'm using proper sources. So that's a problem. So you also need to look into education deeper, and so we have to learn more, and only through education there is way for our development, I think.
We have globalization.
Everybody wants change. But there's some things about change that I think we need to keep in mind. Number one, change for the sake of change accomplishes nothing. Every change should have a purpose. And that purpose needs to be determined before you implement the change. And I want to draw back to what I said about strategic planning. You need to plan change. It's not something you do in a chaotic way. It needs to be organized and structured and managed. So when you think about reforms, just consider the fact those have to be planned. You've got to have a structure within which to do that. So don't get, you know, the young people in the world tend to want immediate change. But those of us who've been around a little bit longer know that effective change can only be accomplished if you plan it and organize it and manage it properly. So this is the role of government. This is the role of the public sector. This is what you as public administrators have to be prepared to do. You have to manage change.
Okay. Police was mentioned a couple of times. I see. But I want to bring like more people, please. I will get back, okay? And police was mentioned a couple of times. And we have, the best person in the group to talk about this, Roman. Bachowski, who actually hired and trained new police in Lviv. So, you know, what's your perspective on that, Roman?
Police. Police reforms is in progress in Ukraine, in Lviv region also, and we have no systemic reforms, but we change people and we change mindsets of those who work in police. And after recruiting a new police, patrol police, we start to assess whole personnel what we have in all system. And in this month, we start the process in Kyiv and Kyiv region, and now preparing Lviv region. It will be a second region where we start. I said we because I coordinating the process in Lviv region with a team of Abdaladze and Hatyrykaninso. But they work in Georgia secret plan. They are not open this plan for the
for simple Ukrainians.
For simple Ukrainian of the Kyiv ministers and also the chiefs, and I think that this is a way to win because.
Can you elaborate on that? What is that?
They keep the plan private, which is, you know, I mean, if you read Sun Tzu's The Art of War, that's what he says in 90% of his writing, you know. So just, I mean, they are in the condition of war internally. I mean, you could see it on all the possible YouTubes and videos, you know. There's a war against them. So if they make their, I can understand them. I mean, with all the sunshine and everything, you know. I mean, if they open up their plans, they will be immediately attacked by the other side. But again, but that puts Roman in the peculiar situation that he has to guess, you know, by body language, what will be done, right?
Yes, the police reform of Ukraine is going in right side, and I think we will win this war, internal war, and.
Even without the plan, you know.
Firing is not the solution. Firing is a very, very small, tiny fragment of this process. Let's say what Georgians did, what Georgian police did, fighting the corruption. It was not like the mentality didn't change swiftly. Like tomorrow, Georgians wake up and said, "Don't take bribe; it's a bad thing." No, of course not. Majority of them, I can't tell you the number, were afraid to take the bribes. Yeah, fear was the most efficient thing why people stopped taking bribes. Because Merabishvili's agency or like police, special department, anti-corruption department, almost every day, maybe on weekly basis, depended, released the videos of the people who get caught. Was it good? Was it good for people? No, of course not. But people were afraid. I'm not saying this is the only solution, of course not. This shouldn't be for the years or for even like several years. But the first thing was fear, of course. But after that, I think that the young generation, people who had education abroad, people who came to the public sector with values, with principles, with ideas, they transformed the rest of the issues. Some people still are who are afraid to take bribes, of course. But the most active citizens of Georgia, the most educated, right now they show the trend in the country that doing this is bad. And the younger generation is coming, the less people are attempting to do that. They don't think about that. They go to a university. They will never think to bribe the professor, which was the case on the law faculty, particularly a couple of years ago, in early 2000s, where in the criminal code of there was like put some kind of dollars or something like that in order to get a good mark.
Really?
This was the case.
That happened in
the Yes, this cool. happened in 2000, in the early 2000s, in during the 90s. My colleagues will certify that. That's perfect. That's perfect. But that was the case. That's why she said that the professor said that. The Georgia was like in the top like five like most corrupted states, and that was the case. So this is we shouldn't fire the people. We should maybe they should be frightened not to, because it's not about like going to jail. It's about their reputation. In Georgia, people do care about that. If next day neighbors will say that people like take a bribe or that that guy, like my neighbor, did something wrong. That was like not only his personal responsibility, but he was responsible for his family and other people's. And it was a shame. Yeah, it's like cultural issue, but it works. Second issue, what I want to stress out, is economic reforms. We're fighting against corruption, but what about economic reforms? Because in Georgia, in economy, there was a lot of reforms. Like the most simple, which there is no cultural like background in this, reduction of the taxes. This is, I think, must have and most important things, and to abolish all the regulations, all these inspections and unnecessary issues, which are like impediment for ordinary citizens and the business, and. These are the issues that should be done. And the last thing about the good governments. Of course, transparency. And I think what was Georgia good thing, and right now it's like slowing down, like public sector was like has an entrepreneurial spirit. I don't know how to say. They were very innovative. They brought a lot of innovation, you know, like public service halls and like Georgian customs. They're very innovative and they sold some services. It's not very traditional. Even Europeans could not like understand this like correctly. They might perceive it differently, but it was very efficient because at the end of the day, always like efficiency, the good salary of the public servant is directly correlated, and one day you'll go to that problem always. So I think like the Georgian like trend to make more entrepreneurial like public sector was a good like experiment, and I think it was successful.
And about the firing all the citizens, let's think about it in a long-term perspective and education. For me, I think it's important that we pay attention to the education on a little bit lower level for maybe high school students, because right now, at least in Ukraine, all the forums, conferences which are organized are for people who are already engaged or already in the civil society. This masters or even bachelor's programs are for those who already decided to be engaged in public or civil society sectors. But I believe that there is a huge need for us as active citizens pay attention at someone who have not decided or didn't have a good example of being an active citizen. And maybe think of education bringing some obligatory or elective course for high level schools.
Higher
education. Yeah. For us.
Go ahead.
For those who are already engaged in the civil society, for politicians, for businessmen to come to the students who haven't decided yet how they want to act on their being a citizen, active citizen in their countries, to see, for example, us who are here, what we are young, what we did, why we did this, and maybe get inspired to be an active citizen. That's one point. The second point is about expertise, maybe low level of expertise. I believe that civil society also has a competition. It operates in some aspects as a business. So we shouldn't complain about low expertise or no expertise in the civil society, but let's grow our own expertise and compete on that market, let's say. And then more and more people would do the same because the civil society organizations compete for the money, for funding, and so on. And the third aspect is that I don't know if we are doing it on purpose or if we should bring the aspect of decentralization in Ukraine, which like we have some strong NGOs on the national level, but if the decentralization reform will go on and more money will be given to regional levels and like this decentralization will happen and different smaller communities will organize themselves, we need to think about the capacity of the NGOs and civil society on the local level and for them to be able to be a watchdog on that level.
The point you raised about public education and the role that public education has in citizenship, Thomas Jefferson, who was the biggest advocate among our founding fathers for public education, said that the single primary function of education in America at that time was to create good citizens. It wasn't about teaching people substance, it was about creating good citizens. So your point is exactly on point. Schools have to do that.
Yes.
So a couple of words about the first, so the entrepreneurial phase of the public service. So well, that's That's not bad, and so Georgia's cases show that yes, in some cases it works and just very rapidly transform environment. On the other hand, we also have the bad examples about the prolonging this entrepreneurial phase of the public service, and just forgetting situation when the that organizations which served in the beginning of the reforms as a kind of the beacons and flagmans and all these kind of things now just serving back. So it means, I mean, well, there are several examples in Georgia. So the another thing also which is very problematic in Georgia, and also I think that it also will be here very problematic, that's to just to the names and state of acts of organizations. For example, in Georgia there are no public organizations, there's no exist. There are state organizations, but they name themselves as public organizations. So that's a big difference. Yeah? So the one thing is when you have state organization and everyone knows that the state is regulated, that is under the minister or prime minister or something like this. Another situation is when we have real independent public organizations. In Georgia we have not that, but we named them. So, and that also creates a lot of misunderstandings, and by the end it's also just interferes and just stopping the development of the society and so on. So I think here we'll be the same problem. Yeah. I don't think that here you have the real public organizations.
Have a crowding out effect. If you have the government which is so overbearing, then it just basically pushes out private initiative.
In previous times, so one of the titles of one of my books is the sociology of the institutional change. So one of the outcomes of that book was that that is not the important. What is the name of the organizations? And what is the name of the the heads of the system were reforming, that's important, what is the content they have. Because in the two societies, this content was one word or concept, for example, police can be totally different. And that also should take when we're reforming into consideration.
Okay, thank you. Vitaly, unfortunately we don't have time for your question, but because we have 2 minutes for closing statements, and let's go in the reverse order. Vitaly, starting from you.
For me, good governance starts from good citizenship, and I think it's never too early to talk about good citizenship from the babyhood, and never too late. And I think especially in post-totalitarian country, education in public administration should have it as a started course, but even more, each course, each subject should touch the good citizenship, and good governance is consequence of good citizenship, in my opinion.
It seems to me that some of our questions and arguments were very similar to those early comparativistic literature from 60s from United States. Maybe Tara will tell us more. They had these questions. Will education help in the process of transformation or not? Yes and not. Yes, on the one hand we have many successful absolutely successful examples, but on the other hand we have a lot of educated ideas at the same time. Will NGOs help this process and create good governance? Yes, sometimes, but not on the other hand. Because we are a different kind of societies, we have different political culture, but we have a lot of successful examples. Yes, we have failed examples like Iran and others, but we have a lot of successful examples, and why not to try to do it? Thanks.
Thank you. I think what we probably concluded here is that if we want a society in which we can feel safe, secure, and comfortable, we as citizens have a responsibility for contributing to that. We have a right to expect government to have a major role to play in that. We have the expectation that non-government organizations and the nonprofit sector will be involved in that. The point is that this is not something that any one entity or group can do. if we really want to have that kind of world, we all have to be engaged in it. And each of us has a responsibility and a role to play. I agree with Natalya that the first place to start is with citizens. We have to take our power back. We have to realize that we are the voice of change. And we have a right to demand it. But we have to be willing to be involved in it as well. So I think that's the lesson we can take away from this. It involves everybody working together. So I think that's where our success will lie.
Thank you, thank you. We have to take our power back. You know, Ukrainians do it from time to time. We have to learn, yes, we have to learn to do it constantly. Not in the way we do it on the squares, but we do it in the classrooms, in the city halls, in the region halls. Okay, thank you.